Look at that face. I fell in love with that face over 20 years ago, and I'm still infatuated. And I've always wanted to do a fun project where I capture my wife's face and recreate it huge. So in this video, I'm going to take you through the entire process of starting from a 3D scan, fixing it up, and carving a giant face like this or this out of blue foam using a CNC machine. And then finishing it so it looks like stonework or concrete work. I started with this RevoPoint Pop 2 3D scanner, and I scanned her face. Now this scanner struggles a bit with hair or dark items. We did a few different poses. I initially wanted to have her doing like a really exaggerated angry pose, like think Tank Girl from the 90s. But ultimately, her face doing a kiss motion was just too much. It was too cute, and I had to go with that and immortalize it. So after scanning, what you'll find is that your mesh is pretty nasty. You know, the scanner can't get things like eyeballs or hair, like I said. So what I did is I brought it into Nomad on the iPad. Since I had to re-sculpt things, I really thought I would take the opportunity to push some of the things that I really liked. For example, her lips, I really highlighted and sharpened some of these angles so that they would really stand out in the end as I lost some detail on things. The crook around her nose, her cheeks, her eyes. Really, the whole thing, I highlighted some of the detail because I was going to lose detail in the process and I wanted it to come through. And the final result, I mean, it looks just like the scan, even though I heightened some things early in the process. I'm super impressed. This looks just like her. It's wild. And before I get too far into this, I want to say thank you to my Patreon supporters. They help me play and do things like this, but also they support my other project, which is where I make game controllers for people with physical disabilities. You can learn more about the Patreon down in the description below. Let's keep going. Once I had the 3D model, well, from that point I could 3D print it or do whatever I wanted, but what I wanted to do was make it huge. Years ago, I played with using blue foam to do large items. This felt like it was really big back then. And what I found is you can buy a whole sheet of this standard blue foam, 2 inches thick, at your local box store right now for about $45 for a 4-foot by 8-foot sheet, which will do something like this with some left over. So I decided I was going to do it with that. To do this, I brought it into vcarve. And they have the ability within vcarve to import a 3D model and split it into layers depending on the thickness you want. Then you lay those layers out and you carve them on your CNC router. Now I use the default settings within vcarve for the actual carving, which means it went pretty slowly. Those settings would be for wood and I was just letting it go nice and slow. Okay, the roughing pass is done. As you can see, we've got these fat layers here. We've got the roughed out shape of the whole thing. And now it's time to go back in with this little quarter inch ball mill. So the roughing pass I did with a half inch regular end mill. The details I'm gonna do with a quarter inch ball mill. The way I was holding all of this down was with some screws through the foam itself, which I was afraid would vibrate and work loose over time if I worked it too hard. So I just let it go slow. I was only making one of these. I don't have to worry about production and the processes being refined or, you know, optimized in any way. It could run all day long. That's not a problem. After it was all carved and ready to go, then what I did was I glued the pieces together using wood glue. That's just because that's what I had. Regular Elmer's glue works just fine. There are some spray adhesives that work, but you have to be careful with sprays because they can eat foam because the propellants that they use. So just regular Elmer's glue is sufficient. And I only used tight bond wood glue because that's what I had that day and I didn't feel like going to the store. Now, after all the pieces are glued together, that's when it comes time to start finishing things. I actually like the blue foam look. I think it's neat looking, but I really wanted to push this a little bit further and get kind of a solid product in the end that I would be happy with, you know, something that I could really say I pulled it off. So I decided to go with a stone look. Now, this meant that I didn't have to sand things as much. If I was going for something smoother, I would sand it a lot more and sand it smooth, but I wasn't worried about that, so I just sanded it as it is. I let the layer lines stay. I didn't fill them in with putty or anything like that. If you wanted this to be perfectly smooth, you could spend some time sanding it down, working from about 80 grit to do shaping up to, you know, like 200 grit for nice smooth surfaces. You would then put Bondo or wood putty in all of your cracks and sand it and sand it and putty and sand and putty and sand until it's smooth. You can do that with this foam. It's entirely doable. But since I decided to go with this concrete or stone look, I actually liked it porous. So I just went straight to, you know, I kind of knocked some edges off, did a tiny bit of shaping, but then I went straight to coating the entire thing in Elmer's glue. Now that was just to make it a little bit more rigid, so that it wouldn't dent or get damaged so easily. That's not a necessary step, but I like the way that it works. So I ended up doing probably 3 to 4 coats of Elmer's glue over this entire thing. I just bought a whole jug of it and painted it on over and over and over and let it dry. Once the Elmer's glue is on, you could theoretically spray paint this with any color you want. However, this blue foam, you have to be very careful with anything that is spray paint especially. They'll have acetones and butanes in them that dissolve them. Even if they say they're safe for craft foam. I found that on some of the Krylon stuff. It says it's safe for craft foam. It is not safe for insulation foam. Liquitex is safe though. So what I did was, even though technically with all of the glue on here, it would have been okay to use Krylon supposedly, I didn't want to risk it because you get pores and pock marks and it eats into it and it gets nasty. I painted the whole thing with gray Liquitex. That's my base coat. Now, after the whole thing is sealed with Liquitex, then you can paint it with whatever you want. It shouldn't go through. You know, you should be safe. So I went back after I painted the base coat of gray, I went back and I did the cracks and anywhere that is going to be kind of where shadows would be or dirt would collect, I used flat black spray paint, just generic, I think it was Krylon Fusion or something. And I put it anywhere there's an overhang where shadows would be to kind of bake in shadows. And then I came back and did another coat of gray kind of from the top down to create some kind of blended effects. You can see it's much darker in here and under here. That's not just the shadows, that's, you know, the part of the process. After that, I thought it looked pretty good, but I really, really wanted to make it pop. I wanted to make the different layers and levels of this really stand out. So I did what's called a wash. Now that was a watered down acrylic paint. I used black and just a touch of burnt umber, which is like a reddish brown. And I coated the whole thing in this. It's watered down. And I did it standing up like this so that it would kind of dribble down and create the effects that this would have had if it was sitting on a wall for years. So if you look in the crevices and cracks, you can see there's kind of a brownish hue to it down deep inside it. And after that dried, then I came back with a lighter gray and did effectively a dry brush where you just put a little bit on the brush and you go over the tops. And so you can see that the key to getting a weathered look and a realistic look is layers and layers and layers and layers. This is a total of about 5 layers. If you really wanted to get realistic, you'd go like 10, 12, 20 layers of just dirt and grime, and then bringing things cleaner again, and then highlighting the highlights, and then dirt and grime over and over and over and over. I am super happy with the way this looks, so I'm leaving it like this. I am just so pleased with how this turned out. It's really fun after a project like this to also look back and see what you would have done differently. So let's start with the scan. What would I have done differently in the scan? Well, I made the mistake of having her look upwards. She was sitting in the chair and I was standing up and she was looking up at me. She's shorter than me. That's how I see her. It seemed natural. But when I hang this on a wall, she's going to be looking upwards. So I would have to hang it really low for it to make any sense to have her looking at me. So I probably would have had her look straight ahead or even down a little bit. Because of the size of this, it would make more sense. Then let's go on to the sculpt. Nothing. I would have done nothing different about the sculpt. But one tip that's good to know is I can use Prusa Slicer. It has a very efficient optimizing engine in it that doesn't lose a lot of detail. And you can preview the optimization. So I took my model, which was like 100 and something megs, dropped it into Prusa Slicer, and reduced the polygon count, exported it, and then took it into Nomad, and it performed much cleaner and smoother in Nomad because it had fewer polygons. On the sculpt itself, I love it. Wouldn't change a thing. Maybe the eyes a little bit smaller, I thought. Once I sculpted it, it looked a little bit weird, but on the final result, I love the eyes. So no, I would leave them the way they are. When it comes to milling this, I would have maybe optimized a little bit. It took 2 days, or I could have done it in one really long day of milling. Since I was doing one, it's no big deal. It can run all day. I don't care. But if you were to make like a set of these, you would really, really want to optimize your milling strategy so that you could get them done much faster. This is not a lot of milling. It should not take forever. So I would ideally find a more secure way to hold down the material and then plow through it much faster. Right now I just took vcarve settings and then I bumped the speed up to 200% in the feed rate. But you could go beyond that. I could have doubled that again as far as speed goes. Close call there. I could have doubled that again as far as speed goes and been safe most likely if my work holding would have held the foam still. That was the part that I wasn't so sure about, you know, especially as it got down to where there wasn't a lot of foam holding still the parts. I was afraid to go too fast because they would break loose and get pulled into my air system that's, you know, vacuuming the whole time. As far as the finish goes, I like the rough finish. I kind of wish I had cut some of these foam pieces vertically a little bit, so there were some vertical lines in here, so it looked more like it was assembled out of pieces than just layers. But really, I think it's fine. I think it looks cool the way it is. I was kind of curious, though. It would be kind of cool to sand one down smooth and do just a super glossy finish. But if you've done any kind of work like that, you know the amount of sanding involved in something for a glossy finish is incredible. You sand the base as smooth as it can be, you paint it, you sand the paint, you paint it again, you sand the paint, you paint it again, you sand the paint, then you put clear coat on, you sand the clear coat, then you put more clear coat. I mean, it's so many steps, so much sanding, I didn't want to do it. So I'm happy with the way this goes. And then finally for the paint, I'm really happy with how it turned out. I'm tempted to try just dripping some more stuff on it, you know, to let it actually just run down it like it's been sitting in the rain, but I also don't want to ruin it. So I might just leave it the way it is. But in the future, if I were playing around more, I would be tempted to do more. I may put a coat of matte polycrylic or something on it to protect it more, but since this is going up on the wall in my office, it's not going to be in the sunlight. It's not going to be getting wet. Probably just leave it the way it is. Thank you for watching. I hope you enjoyed this. If you have any questions about how to make this, or if you wanted to make your own and you needed questions answered about the process, feel free to ask down below. I'm so happy with this. I'm eager to hang it up somewhere. I've got the perfect spot right over my computer that I work at every day. It's going to be on my wall looking at me. It's going to be delightful.